Welcome to this video lecture on the gastrointestinal tract, where we will review the structure, function, and histological makeup of each part of the digestive tract. My name is Christopher Demas, and I'll be walking you through these topics. The gastrointestinal tract is made up of a long muscular tube, which is open at the oral and anal ends. The sections of the gastrointestinal tract include the oral cavity, the pharynx, the esophagus, the stomach, small intestines, large intestines or colon, appendix, rectum, and anal canal. We will be discussing these structures in detail, starting with the esophagus. Let's look at a section of the esophagus and use it as a model for the rest of the digestive tract. The first, most inner layer of the digestive tract is the mucosa. The mucosa can be subdivided into three additional layers, which include the innermost epithelial layer, the middle thin supporting connective tissue layer known as the lamina propria, and a thin layer of smooth muscle on the outermost part of the mucosa called the muscularis mucosa. Let's go ahead and label those three layers now. The next layer is the submucosa, or the layer just below the mucosa, which is a thicker layer of connective tissue and often contains blood vessels, glands, and the autonomic nerve plexus called the Meissner plexus. You can remember this since the Meissner plexus is responsible for regulating the glandular secretions and the blood flow in these tissues. The third main layer is the muscularis propria, which contains two layers of muscle that run perpendicular to each other. The inner layer runs circumferentially, while the external layer runs longitudinally. Lastly, there is another layer of connective tissue that surrounds the entire tube that is called either serosa or adventitia. Serosa is found only surrounding the gastrointestinal tract within the peritoneal cavity, while adventitia is found where the gastrointestinal tract is outside of the peritoneal cavity, which includes parts of the esophagus that is above the diaphragm, as well as segments of the bowel. If you find this confusing, do not worry, since we'll come back to it later. Now that we have reviewed the general construct of the gastrointestinal tract, let's begin by looking more closely at the esophagus. I'm going to now insert a picture of the esophagus. Go ahead and pause the video and see if you can identify the layers just described, and then I will reveal the labels. The beginning of the gastrointestinal tract, or the esophagus, and the end of the gastrointestinal tract, the anus, both have stratified squamous epithelium. Supporting the epithelium is loose connective tissue that makes up the lamina propria, and the last layer of the mucosa is the muscularis mucosa that delineates the bottom of the mucosa. The submucosa is just beneath, which contains connective tissue, clusters of mucus-producing glands, blood vessels, and nerves. Beneath these layers is the muscularis propria. Notice how there are two layers of muscle. The more internal layer has circularly oriented muscles following the contours of the lumen, and the external layer is longitudinally oriented and is coming out at you in this section. I would like to take a moment to note that the first two-thirds of the esophagus contains skeletal muscle, while the last two-thirds of the esophagus contains smooth muscle. This means that the middle one-third portion of the esophagus contains both skeletal and smooth muscle in its muscularis propria. This is important and can be remembered since you have conscious control over swallowing, so the first two-thirds must contain the only type of muscle that you can actively control, skeletal muscle. Finally, since this part of the esophagus would be above the diaphragm, the outside of the esophagus would contain adventitia. Right before the esophagus connects to our next structure, there is a junction that you should be familiar with, known as the GE, or the gastroesophageal junction. This junction is characterized by the abrupt change from stratified squamous cells to simple columnar cells. That is all you need to be familiar with this part of the tract. Now we are going to move on to the stomach. The stomach is subdivided into four distinct areas based on the histology of the tissue in these areas. The four areas are the cardia, near the connection point of the esophagus and the stomach, the top of the stomach called the fundus, the length of the stomach called the body, and the sphincter region of the stomach called the pylorus region. An important difference between the organization of the stomach and the rest of the GI tract is that the stomach has three layers of muscle within the muscularis propria that are oriented in three different directions. The innermost layer is oriented transversely, the middle layer is oriented horizontally, and the outermost muscular layer is oriented vertically. A way to remember that the stomach has three layers of muscle is by their function, which is to better mix the contents within the stomach. Lastly, if we look at the gross structure of the stomach, you will notice the ridge and folded structure of the stomach. This inner structure is called rugae. I mentioned earlier that one reason that the stomach is separated into different parts is due to the different histological structures. Let's take a closer look at that now. We will focus on the cardia, the fundus and the body together, as well as the antrum or pylorus. We will begin with the cardia, which is shown on the far left. Notice how the pits are relatively short, lined with mucus cells, and the glandular section is also short that is found below the pits. The fundus and the body are similar to the cardia in that they have short pits, however they have long glands as shown in the middle slide. This large glandular region is the location of parietal and chief cells. Parietal cells are responsible for maintaining the acidic environment by secreting hydrochloric acid and are bright pink on H&E stain. Chief cells sit towards the bottom of the glands, are more blue, and assist in digestion by secreting an enzyme called pepsinogen that is cleaved to form pepsin in the acidic environment of the lumen of the stomach. On the right is a slide of the antrum or pyloric region, and this part of the stomach contains long pits and short glands that just contains mucus cells. Overall, this length ratio is going to be an important way for you to distinguish between the different parts of the stomach, and something you should be familiar with. Now I think is a good time to take a short break. We will continue with the second part of the digestive tract lecture in the next video.